Wow, that was quite the rollout. Thank you, guys. You can have a seat. Thank you so much, man. Can we just give it up for Fern and Marty one more time, Social Club? How good was that? So good to be anywhere, but it's really good to be here. Anybody know what I'm talking about? It's good to be anywhere, but it's really good to be here. And I want to just honor Pastor Joel and Victoria. I got to hang out with Pastor Joel for a little bit before tonight. And he's doing so good, as always. And I just want to say that through the last year and a half, any pastors have done an amazing job to lead us all through these crazy times. And so if you haven't thanked Pastor Joel and Victoria lately, or thank God for them lately, do that. Because it's been crazy times to lead the people. And I love them so much and respect them. The father of it all, Mr. Nix, right over here. So good to see you. And awesome to be here, Miss Doty. Doesn't miss church. If you're ever having a hard day and just wondering if you can do it again, Miss Doty never misses church. So I always think about that. And I was hoping that you would be here tonight. And I knew you would. But I wanted to see you. And it's just so good to be here. The team led. The worship was so great. And it's so good to be here tonight. I'm praying tonight that what we've been talking about this whole time will land in your story. Because it's possible that by the time you leave here tonight, you can be free. And everything might not change in the next few minutes, but the next few minutes can change everything. That's how powerful this night is. So we're not going to say, hey, if we just snap our fingers, everything can change. But in the next few minutes, what God's going to say to you can change everything about your life. And so I want to ask him to do that. We've already sung some of my message today. Alexandra sang like a third of my talk already, so I might just let you come and close with that same song. But it's believing it, it's receiving it, and it's knowing that you have the power to change the way you think. That's the message I came here to share tonight. In Jesus Christ, you have the power to change the way you think. In other words, you don't have to leave here tonight thinking like somebody told you to think, or believing about you what somebody said about you, or believing that you can or can't do something because somebody said you can or can't do that, or because of the family that you came from, or the background that you have, or the things that you've been through, or the places where you stumbled, or the doubt that you've had, or the frustration that you're trying to deal with, or the depression that tried to get into your story. None of that has power over you. God is giving you the ability to change the way you think. And you can start doing that right here and right now. You don't have power to do a lot of things. And right now, a lot of us don't feel like we have power to control hardly anything at all. But you can control the way you think. And you have the power to change your mind. And God wants to help all of us do that tonight. So let's ask him. Father, thank you that you give us power. Thank you that your words are true. I pray that the truth of your words would break through the lies tonight. And I'm asking you to do it in Jesus' name. Amen. I have my Bible with me, and my Bible has a small problem. You're like, what's wrong with the Word of God? Nothing's wrong with the Word of God. Just something's wrong with my Word of God. And I know we're in kind of like social distancing, so I want to be careful, but I need a couple volunteers tonight. By the way, is anyone taking notes tonight at all here with a pen? Is anybody taking notes with a pen? If you're taking notes with a pen on a piece of paper, can you raise your hand really high? Okay, because I'm going to need a few of you. So if you feel comfortable in a minute, I'm going to need four of you who are taking notes with a pen on a piece of paper to come and let me borrow your notes and your pen for a minute. And we'll get them sanitized and get them back to you and all that. But I'm going to need four people. So if you got a pen and a piece of paper. By the way, the title of this message is called Take the Pen in Your Hand. Can you say that with me? Take the pen in your hand. Let's try to say it together. Take the pen in your hand. Now, those of you who are taking notes on your phone, a pen is a long plastic item that has a little tube of liquid ink inside of it. and you write on a tree that got made really thin, and you can see it, and it never disappears. You can't lose it, you can't close it, you can't delete it. It's right there. It's on paper. It's amazing. We'll look at that later. But I need a volunteer, somebody that feels comfortable, to come and just help me for a second. Anybody feel comfortable coming down and helping me? Somebody? Okay, great, yes. You actually have a notes and a pen, and you're going to come help me. This is a triple win. This is not a trick question. This is not a trick question, but I'm just going to see. It might be a trick question, so no pressure. Okay, I don't need the notebook this time, but I might next time. I'll call on you. Can you just hold my Bible for a minute? What's your name?
Ariel.
Ariel. And can you see, where are we right here?
Luke 23:13.
Can you say just a little louder?
Luke 23:13.
Okay, so we're Luke 23:13, and then turn the page to what? Where are we?
23:13.
And then when you turn the page to the next, go over to the next page, where are we? See there? See, it worked. It's weird, isn't it?
You're John 2:16.
John 2. So we went from Luke 23, which is the last chapter of Luke, to John 2. This is not a magic trick, by the way, in case you're thinking it's a setup for something where I'm going to do something and make something appear. So we're at Luke 23, and then the very next page is John chapter 2. So what is missing?
Everything.
Everything. Well, no, we got Luke 23, and we got John chapter 2, but something's missing. What's missing? John 1 is missing. Yeah. Well, that's the end of Luke, but we missed in the beginning of John.
Oh, that's nice.
Isn't that weird? That's why it was on sale. They were 75% off. No, that's not true. So, Miss Doty, I know you're like, what has happened here? Louis has lost his mind, and his theology is on thin ice. So, my Bible, this Bible, fell apart. It fell apart because I'm so spiritual. No, it fell apart because I use this for my everyday life, not just my Bible reading, but what I'm doing right now. So for example, I went on a Christmas tour one time, and I was on like 60 nights of a Christmas tour preaching about the Christmas story, and I had my Bible open to the Christmas story in Luke right there. And after the tour, my thumb had made a hole in the page. Because I had held my Bible for 60 days to Luke chapter 2, and so I had a hole in that page, and some of the other pages were coming loose. The whole thing was made on the outside, made out of duct tape. The whole Bible was coming undone. Stuff was falling out, and it was the end of the road, and I just said, I got to get rid of this Bible. And then we thought, well, maybe we can find somebody to rebind it for you. And we looked and looked and looked, and everybody was like, no, it's too far gone to get rebound. You just need to get another one. So we got another one. And when we got the other one, we found this one man in America who can rebind books, like miraculously. And he said, I can even rebind your Bible. And he did. Look how nice that looks. Now, the Luke 2 page is kind of weird because it sticks up. Y'all are like, this is the craziest night we've ever come to. The man is doing Bible tricks. We've never seen anything like it. The reason it is because the man went and photocopied my page with the hole in it so that I have all my notes from before, but then he somehow fixed the hole and put a new page in. And that's like all of Colossians is like that. Colossians sticks way up. Because Colossians was in bad shape. And so he photocopied it all, and I got my Bible back. And so I was so excited. And then I was reading my Bible one day, and I was like, oh man, I don't have Luke. I got Luke, but I don't have John 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God. I don't have that. And the Word became flesh and dwelled among us. He came full of grace and full of truth. I don't have that. What is going on? And then I went, oh, now I remember. You're like, please tell us what you're talking about and get on with your sermon. So when my Bible was not going to get fixed, my friend went on a SpaceX rocket to the International Space Station. We have a photo of the space station in case you don't know what we're talking about. That's not a toy. That's real. That's Earth and a thing where my friend is right now. He's in there right now. It's weird. We could email him right now, and he'd probably email us back if he's not asleep yet. And he said, I could take anything to the space station for you if it's small. And it'll fly around for 6 months around the Earth, 17,500 miles an hour. And then when we come back, I'll give it back to you, and you'll have something that's been in space. I was like, okay. He said, what would you like me to take? And I said, I'd like you to take John chapter 1 out of my Bible. And my Bible was already falling apart, Fern, so it didn't matter. So I just pulled it out. It came right out. And I sent it to him at NASA, and it's up on the space station right now. And so I'm a little short, but I have the whole Bible on my phone, thank goodness. But when he comes back, I'm going to get it put back in my Bible. And I will have a page of my Bible while I'm preaching, which has been in space. Now, I was telling somebody that the other day, and they said, I can't believe that. That's just crazy that you're going to have a page of your Bible that's been from Earth to space for 6 months, and then back to Earth and back in your Bible. And I said, well, if you think that's crazy, check this out. This whole Bible came down from heaven to Earth. Hello? So I think somebody, Nick, could be more impressed that a page of my Bible went to space than they are that the whole Bible came down from heaven. So whether you've got it on a phone right now or you have one right now, could you just hold it? If you don't have one on your phone or in real life right now, what are you doing? This is the sermon. And can you just think with me for a moment? I am holding God's miraculous breath, because that's what the word says about the word, that it is all God breathed. So it's not just ink on a page, it's God's breath on a page. And can you just think with me for a minute? I am 17 years old, and I am holding God's word in my hand. The end. There is nothing in your life more miraculous than that. That the God of the universe wanted you to hear his voice so badly that he sent his word from heaven, and you are holding it in your hands. You are holding a miracle in your hands. But here's the thing. That's amazing, but the enemy isn't impressed. And so what the enemy's going to do tonight is say, oh, so you have a miracle in your hands. So what? You know that your parents don't really care. Oh, so what? You know that you're not good enough. Oh, you're holding a miracle in your hands? Oh, isn't that wonderful? You know you've messed up too much for God to ever use you. Oh, you're holding a miracle in your hands? Well, you know what? It doesn't really matter, because you might not even make it through this situation. And all of a sudden, we have a miracle word from God to us in our hands, breath on a page. But the enemy, he doesn't care about that. He's so bold that he came into paradise and lied to Adam and Eve. Now, you've got to be like bold, brash, crazy thinking. Oh, I know what I'm going to do. I'm going to go into paradise. I know why he lies to me, because I got a parent-in-law with cancer for 8 years. I lost both my parents to debilitating diseases. I've been in a hole of depression for 4 months of my life. I've been through every kind of hardship you can go through. I know why he lies to me, because he comes into my story, into the confusion, into the weakness, into the pain, and says, God doesn't love you. God doesn't care. God isn't good. God can't be trusted. I know why he lies to me, but how did he have the boldness to go into paradise? What was he going to say to Adam and Eve? Y'all having marital problems? No. Y'all feel bad about anything? No. Are you having any health problems? No. Do you know anybody that you're not in good relationship with? No. They were in paradise. And the enemy came in and started lying to him right in the middle of paradise. So don't think he won't come lying to you tonight. It's what he does. Jesus said he's a liar from the start, and it's all he does. And I bet he's lying to you right now. And so what God wants you to do tonight is take the pen in your hand. Can you say that one more time with me? Take the pen in your hand. And do what? Cross out the lies and start writing, according to God's word, a true future for your life. And here's the thing. He wants you to write it. You did not write the word. Let's be clear. You did not write the scripture. God took the pen in his hand, and through human people, he says in the Bible, through the prophets and human people, through the Spirit of God, God gave us the scriptures. But now he wants you to take a pen, and he wants you to agree with him for your life. In other words, this isn't something somebody's going to do for you. You're going to do this for you. You're not going to be able to say, well, nobody did that for me, because you can do this for you. And you can begin to change the story of your life. It says this in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 3. And I want to give you a couple of references tonight, and I might not read them all, but I want you to go and read them when you get home. 2 Corinthians 10 tells us the power that we have. That page doesn't stick up, so I got to flip my way over to it. Give me a second. This is what it says in 2 Corinthians 10. Actually, we'll start in verse 3. It says, "For though we live in the world, we do not wage war as the world does. The weapons we fight with are not the weapons of the world. On the contrary, they have divine power to demolish strongholds." Now, this is starting to get very personal. "We demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God." In other words, anything comes in my story that's contrary to what God has already given me in his word, okay, I'm fighting against that. I'm recognizing it. I'm understanding what's happening. And I'm going to stop it. And he says, here's how it works. "We demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God, and we take captive every," what? "Every," say it with me, "every thought." We take captive every thought. Why? Because where the enemy wants to win is in your mind. Because if he can win your mind, he can destroy your life. So he's not trying to destroy your life. He's trying to win your mind. Because if he wins your mind, he'll destroy your life. If he makes you think that you're not good enough for God's love, you're done. If he can lie to you and tell you you are not worthy to be loved by God, you are finished, because you're going to run to everything on planet Earth to try to get love because you don't think you're worthy of God's love. And in the process of that, you're going to ruin your life and the life of everybody around you. You know why? Because he won your thought. And that's why Paul is saying we take every thought captive to make it obedient to Christ. In other words, we see the enemy coming. We know he's a liar from the start. And when he starts lying to us, we realize, oh, this does not match up to the breath of God on the page that came down from heaven into my hands. Therefore, that thought does not get to stay in my mind. I might not can keep the thought from getting to my mind, but I can certainly keep it from staying in my mind. And you know how you do that? You do it by connecting your thoughts to the truth of God. Okay, so how does that work practically? I'll show you, and I'll give you some scripture to back it up. Let's take four lies really quick. that I believe the enemy is telling someone in this room right now. And at the end of this lie, I'm going to give us the truth. And if that's you, and God speaks to you, and it's revelation for you, and you're like, God has brought me here tonight to tell me that, and I'm going to take back my mind right now, starting right here and right now, I'm going to have you stand. Just stand. That's it. We're not going to do a big prayer, big response. Just stand. At the end of this lie, if this is your lie, your first thing tonight is you're just going to stand up and say, that has been my lie, and tonight, I'm taking the pen in my hand. Say, so what does that look like? Could I borrow a piece of paper and a pen, a real pen from anyone? Just looking somebody, well, okay. That, I like it when you improvise. Okay, the first lie. And I need somebody to help me with this on the camera if you can. Here's the first lie, are you ready? The first lie is, I am not enough. I'm not enough. I'm not good enough. I'm not smart enough. I'm not pretty enough. I didn't come from the right family. I don't have the right experience. I don't have what it takes. I'm not enough. Thank you, as you were setting up the song that you sang, it was just leading us into that whole moment. How many of us in this room tonight are holding the miracle of God in our hands, but yet we are believing that we're not enough? It is the national sport right now. Living out of, I'm not enough. And it's at the root of all the anxiety and the depression and all the darkness that's coming in and the suicide rate that's off the chart. What's at the root of that? I'm not enough. And there could be 1,000 reasons. We could take the rest of tonight and tomorrow and just go through all of them. My dad walked out, and he told me it wasn't about me, but when he said it wasn't about me, I heard him say it was about me. And I've been thinking the whole time, it was something about me that made my dad walk out that door. And I don't know what it was about me, because I didn't know that I did something to cause my dad to walk out that door, but I must have done something. And he kept saying, baby, it's not about you. And I kept hearing, it's about you. And maybe that was the seed. And that seed went in the ground. And everybody's tried to come around and say, man, you're awesome. You're incredible. God loves you. But for you, that seed got in there. And it told you, I am not enough. And you've been fighting it and trying to overcome it. But you've been living out of that lie. And you know where that lie came from? It came from the liar who's been lying from the start. And what's amazing is everybody in here looks incredible. I mean, I've been scanning the whole time I've been up here talking. There's not one person in this room that does not look amazing. Everybody looks great. But behind the I look great, I wonder how many people are in the room right now fighting up a hill that says, I'm not enough. And you've kind of either given up, I'll never be enough, or you've mapped out a plan. This is what I'm going to do to prove that I'm enough. And either one of those paths are not the plans of God for your life. So what do, Louis? I go to the Word, and I get in the Word, and when I get in the Word, I get a new story. I'm going to give you two places where there's a new story. Number one, Jeremiah 31:3. Long story here, but the people of God have been taken out of Jerusalem and Israel. They're in captivity, but God's going to return them to their home. And he's promising them all of his love for them. And Jeremiah 31:3 says, I have loved you with an everlasting love. You connect that over to Ephesians chapter 1, verse 3. And that's what the setup to the song was, which is what kind of made me crazy for a minute. The setup to the song from Ephesians 1 is, I chose you in Christ before the foundation of the world. Amen. So before there was an earth, I saw you. And I said, him. And then it says, and in love, the next verse, Ephesians 4, chapter 1, verse 4, and he predestined you in his love. So he chose you before the foundation of the world. He predestined you in his love. So God has always loved you. Hello? He's always loved you. Before there was a world to be on, God loved you. Before you even knew there was a God, God already wanted you to be with him. Before you said, I want you, God said, no, I want you. So you've never been forsaken. You've never been forgotten. Never. Because before there was a you, there was God, and God was already loving you before there was a you. Yeah, but then when I got in the story, blah, 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 my parents, my family, my friend, my whatever, me, and all the stuff happened, he's like, yeah, before there was your parents, and before there was you, and before all the stuff happened, there was me, and when there was me, I loved you. And I didn't love you because you had done anything super amazing. I loved you because I chose to love you because I made you. And I think you're amazing. So, if anybody's got a lie going, how do you take that thought captive and make it obedient to Jesus? You take the pen in your hand. And I want to encourage you to really do this. So, you'll need to go home and get a pen and find your journal and do it with a real pen. And I want you to write the lie in your journal. Oh, I've written some in my journal in the last year and a half. The enemy's lying to me, and I would just write the lie down on a piece of paper and just stare at it. Like, I'm not going to ignore it, act like it doesn't exist. I'm just going to stare right at it. And then I would take the pen, and I would say, okay, above this, I'm going to write the truth. So what is the truth? Well, I've loved you with an everlasting love. I chose you before the foundation of the world. I predestined you in my love to be adopted as children and in my family. I'm like, okay, here's what's true. I am loved with an everlasting love. And now I'm going to take the pen and I'm scratching out the lie and I'm circling my new story. And you think the enemy's going to be impressed with that? No. He's going to go, oh my word, he took out the pen. I've been lying to her for, 29 years. Had her all pinned down into the darkness for, her whole adolescent life. Oh, but look, she went to Lakewood, Hope and Life, and wrote some notes on a card. Woo! All right, call off all the darkness. No. He's going to come to you and say, what do you think? You think that's going to change you? You're a nobody. Nobody cares about you. Nobody ever cared about you. You're never going to measure up. You're never going to make it. You're never going to be anybody. Nobody cares. You don't matter. Forget it. People wouldn't even notice if you weren't here. And you're looking at that thing going, oh, man, I don't know if this is going to work. No. When he comes and starts telling you that, you're going to go, you have to go. Because I have the truth in my mind. And so I'm not going to fight the lie. I'm just going to embrace the truth. I got a story. Let me tell you my new story. Are you still here? Okay, in Jesus' name, let me tell you my new story. I am loved with an everlasting love. That's my story. Well, no, you're not, because if you were loved with an everlasting love, you wouldn't have gone through the hardship you've gone through. Listen, man, Jesus went through more hardship than I went through to prove that I'm loved with an everlasting love. So I believe I'm loved with an everlasting love. I'm going to stick with the story that God told me about me. That's my story, and I'm sticking with it. And if you say, that sounds like preacher talk and hype and church talk, I was talking to a neuroscientist the other day. I couldn't understand half of what she said. But I understood this. She said, Louis, you can change your mind. Not Bible talk, not scripture talk, not church talk, science talk, you can change your mind. She said it takes 66 days. And if you think any thought for 66 days, you dwell on that thought, you create a neuro highway in your mind. So if you think a negative thought for 66 days, guess what? Highway. And if you think it for 6 years and 66 days, guess what? You got the 610 loop on steroids right up here. You got 18 wheelers coming down. So you can't change this by coming down and having a 66-second moment. But if for 66 days you say, I'm waking up in the morning and I'm agreeing with God's word, I am loved with an everlasting love, and I'm going to stay with that all day today, no matter what happens. Tomorrow, I'm going to stay with that. The next day, 66 days later, you have created a new highway in your brain. And the highway says, I'm loved with an everlasting love. So I just wonder, is that revelation for anybody here tonight? And you want to say, man, I don't know how you got here. I'm not even still sure who you are. But God brought me here to hear that. And I'm taking that thought captive starting right here and right now. And I'm taking the pen in my hand and I'm scratching out the lie. And I'm starting a whole brand new story. I'm writing down God's new story of my future. I'm loved with an everlasting love. Is that anybody? I just invite you to stand up just for a moment, just to say, this is my new story. Just for 2 seconds, just stay standing. See, because the enemy said, it's not going to work. It's not going to work for you. But you said, no, it is going to work for me. I'm standing up. You took the pen in your hand. God bless you. That's step one of a journey that's going to change the way you think. You can be seated. That's amazing. Okay, can we do that real fast a couple more times? I got to hurry for time's sake. Thank you so much. Put it on my tab. May I borrow somebody else's notebook? Anybody? Thank you. Wonderful. Got their Olympic t-shirt on. Couldn't be better. Thank you so much. Do you mind if I write in it?
Of course.
Okay, thank you so much. You can stay or go or whatever. I'll try to make it a little bit quicker. Okay, here's the lie. Are you ready? Maybe you're hearing this lie. I'm not going to make it through this. I don't know what the this is, but the enemy just told you, you're not going to make it. You're like, how do you know the enemy told me that? Because the good shepherd told you we were going through the valley of the shadow of death. Yeah. Philippians 4, reading down to verse 13. Verse 13 is the verse we all know. Maybe you could say it if I start it. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. That's an incredible verse. But the writer, Paul, is talking about how hard things have been. And in the verses right above it, he says, I've been in times when I had enough, and I've been in times when I didn't have enough. I've been in times where I knew where it was all coming from, and I've been in times where I didn't know where anything was coming from. I've been in the good and the bad. I've been in the ups, and I've been in the low. So this is real talk. It's not some Bible author going, yeah, I'm blessed and highly favored. He says, oh no, I've been like on the margin. And there was another time where I was like in plenty. And as he comes down to the end, his conclusion is, but you know what I've learned through it all? I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. That's called context. So that when you and I get in the high, we don't really need that verse. When you're at your best, you don't go, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. But when you're a girl in our church who just finished her freshman year of college, and she woke up one morning going into her senior year of high school out of a coma in a hospital room, and when she woke up, her mom said to her, Nan, I have some bad news. You lost your right leg. Precious, beautiful young girl. And she was like in shock. And she scanned the room really fast. Her aunt was there, her sister, her mom, one of the pastors from our church were there. And she scanned the room and she said, where's dad? And her mom said, dad went to heaven. In the accident where they smashed into each other on a lake, Dad went to heaven and she woke up without a right leg, going into her senior year of high school. Her name's Nan. And a few days after, I went to visit her in the trauma hospital in our city where she got life flighted. And God had just told me and given me a picture. And so I walked in and I had not even met Nan before. She was just a student in our youth group. And I didn't, you know, what do you say? They don't teach you in your Bible college what you say in that moment. But God had given me a clear picture. And I walked into her hospital room, I'll never forget it, and I said, Nan, I know that the enemy has been in this room telling you for the last, whatever it was, 6 days since you woke up out of the coma, what you're not going to be able to do in your life. You're not going to be able to do this, and you're not going to be able to do that, and you're not going to be able to do this, and you're not going to be able to do this, and you're not going to be able to do this, and you can't 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 do this. I want you to start making a list right here on this wall. I said, imagine this as an imaginary tablet, and I want you to start writing on it every day the things you can do. Because Nan, I'm telling you right now, you can raise up a song and worship the Almighty God right now with one leg. You can finish high school. You can be at the top of your class. You can, and she ended up being the homecoming queen at her school. You can have a future. You can have a family. You can have an impact. You can make a difference on planet Earth. You can walk again. You can run again. You can go back to that lake again and overcome that moment again. You can. You can, because you can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. So what is the story then? The story is, it's a lie. You're not going to make it through this season. You're not going to make it through this school year. You're not going to make it through COVID. You're not going to make it through your parents' divorce. You're not going to make it through this breakup with this friend. You're not going to make it through this depression that you're in. It's a lie. How do I know it's a lie? Because the only way the enemy can tell you that you're not going to make it is because every other time he told you that you weren't going to make it, it was a lie. Hello? Because you're here. You can't lie to somebody who's not here. And if you're here, then when he told you you weren't going to make it, he was lying. And he's lying to you now. You're going to make it. I'm telling you, this isn't hype. I'm not here to hype anybody up. I'm telling you, I don't know what your story is, but you're going to make it. I don't know what you're up against, but you're going to make it. I don't know how hard it is, but you're going to make it. I don't know how dark it is, but you're going to make it. Why? Because you can do all things through Christ who gives you strength. And he promised you that he's taking you through the valley, not to the valley. So I have a new story. And my new story is, I'm writing above the line now, God has brought me, hallelujah, through every trial and every circumstance. That's true. That's true. Anybody want to deny that? Anybody want to tell me that God hadn't brought me through every trial and every circumstance I found myself in my life? Oh yeah, but you got knocked down. No kidding. I got scars all over my body. Whittling with a Swiss Army knife, my dad brought me back from Europe when I was 10 years old, but he told me 100 times, when you carve on wood, don't do it towards your body, do it away. I was doing as hard as I could toward it, sliced my whole hand open. That's a scar to prove it. I got all kinds of scars on my life, but I made it through. A scar just shows that you made it. And this is a truth. God has brought me through every, I left that one out, trial and every circumstance. I'm going to have to scratch out the lie. And I'm going to circle the truth. And I have a new story. for my life. So if you were to text me or we were to go to coffee and you would say, so how's it going? And you knew it wasn't going good, I wouldn't say, oh, it's going fantastic. I would say, man, it is hard. It is hard right now. I mean, it's like really hard. But God has brought me through every trial and every circumstance. I got no reason to believe he's not going to bring me through this time. I got a new story. So just curious, did it God bring anybody here tonight to take that thought captive and make it obedient to Jesus? Anybody? God's going to bring me through. See, the enemy, he told you, don't stand up. I know you're thinking about standing up, but don't stand up because that's dumb. But you stood up anyway. You took the pen in your hand. Take the pen in your hand because God is giving you the power to change the way you think. Yeah, God bless each one of you that's standing, especially you right there. I'm trying to find, I'm over time because I've been looking at two different clocks, so I'm out of time. So can I borrow one more piece of paper real fast? I promise I'll go quick. Oh, thank you so much. I'm sorry. Can I just borrow one more real fast? Yes, thanks. Boy, that's a boss-sized notebook. That's a sketch pad. That's a creative person coming. The faith is bigger than fear journal. You mind if I write in it? Thank you. Okay, so we'll do this one real quick. I'm too messed up to be used by God. That's the lie. But the devil's not scared. He's not scared of you. He's not scared of the fact that you have a Bible in your hands. He's not scared of the fact that you've got miracle breath of God on a page right in front of you. He's not scared of the fact that you're at church tonight. He's not scared that you like social club. He's not scared that you come into hope and life. He's not scared that you have Christian friends. He's not scared of any of that. He will lie into paradise. He's going to lie to you, and he's going to tell you, you are too messed up to be used by God. So you can come sit in the deal, but you're not going to ever be used by God. Or you can come and be a part, but you're not going to ever be used by God. So I'll just give you a couple of references you can check out. 1 Timothy 1:12-17, write that one down. And 2 Corinthians 12:9-10. That's the same guy we were just listening to. And he said, I love God's grace because I was the worst of all sinners. And he said, but now amazingly, even though I was the worst of all sinners, God's grace is being shown to the world through me. That was Apostle Paul talking. And he said in a different place, he said that I boast about my weakness because when I'm weak, then I'm strong. You know why? Because God's grace is sufficient for me. So in the miracle words on the page, in the breath on the page, all the people that God's using to write with his hand, the breath of God on the page for you and me, all of them are messed up. There's not one of them in here that wasn't messed up. Paul wrote most of the New Testament, and he killed Christians, tried to shut down the early church. Stood by when Stephen got put to death. They said they put their robes at the feet of Paul. So this guy is messed up big time until Jesus finds him. And when Jesus finds him, he puts mercy and grace on his life. He forgives him, opens his eyes, gives him revelation, lets him see he has a part of the story to play. And then God puts him in the story. And it turns out that his past doesn't prohibit him from being in the story. It actually becomes the thing that launches him further in the story. That doesn't mean you need to go mess your life up so you can be used by God. Amen. It just means if you have messed your life up, you're not out of the equation yet. Because if God can't use a messed up person, then he's not going to be using any people. So I have a new story based on the Word of God, those two passages in particular. And my new story is this: God's grace shines through my weakness. I got a new story, and I'm going to take the pen in my hand, and I'm crossing out the lie. I'm just writing over it. Lie. Liar. This came from asterisk L. H-E asterisk L is where that came from. This is what God's Word says. This is my story. It's my new story. Listen, taking the thought captive is possible, but you have to take the pen in your hand. And I'm just going to preach for 1 minute. And some of you are not going to like this, but you need to hear it. Some of you are not going to do this. And in 5 years, you're going to be sitting in a hole somewhere blaming somebody. And it will not be their fault. Yes, they contributed to the chaos. They were a part of all the hurt. They were in the story, but then God got in the story, and God gave you a miracle in the story. He gave you truth in the story, and he said, take it up and take the thought captive. You got the power to change your mind. No, they don't have the power over your mind. You, in Jesus' name, can take that thought captive and make it obedient to Jesus. So you can't blame it on anybody. You can't blame it on the circumstance. You can't blame it on yourself. At the end of the day, you have to take responsibility. So can I say today, wake up, oh sleeper, and take back your table. You have the power, not in and of yourself, but in Christ, to change the way you think. I have a new story. My new story is, man, I got stuff. But God's grace, it shines even more brightly through my weakness. So I'm not going to try to hide my weakness. I'm going to say I had it. Because when I say I had it, you'll be like, really? It's like when I came out of that depression a decade ago. And I got better, got back in the light. Miracle for me. I mean, I thought I'd never see the light of day again. I didn't leave the house for 4 or 5 months. And I got better, and I could preach again. Had light in my eyes again. I could feel the wind of the Holy Spirit in my back again. I had my calling back. And I went on this tour in arenas like this every night, some other basketball arena, a hockey arena somewhere with thousands of people. Got ready to go on the tour, and God said, I want you to talk about being in that pit. I went, what? We're over that. We're done. I'm good. He goes, yeah, go talk about it. Because a lot of people had never seen somebody up on a platform at a Christian event say that they'd been in a hole of darkness. And when I said it, people believed it. And when I said, you're going to make it, they went, okay, maybe I will make it. This dude's been down. He sounds like he's been down in where I've been down in. And God brought me out so that his grace could shine through my weakness and magnify his strength. So So if the enemy has told you, you are too messed up to be used by God, and you are choosing right now not to believe that lie anymore, I want to invite you just to stand. That's your first step of taking the pen in your hand. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. I got a new story. I'm going to start a new story. 66 days of a new story. God's word in my mind, 66 days, a new story. I'm not too messed up to be used by God because God's grace shines through my weakness. Yeah, God bless each one of you. Thank you for standing up. Thank you. So we're going to close here with the last one. I'm not going to write in anybody's journal. This last one. I'm not good enough to be saved. Can you see it? Because I'm not writing it. Can you see it? Okay, little curveball. It's not a lie. Hello? Did you see that coming? You didn't see it coming? It's not a lie. It's true. You're not good enough to be saved. So if the enemy ever comes and tells you you're not good enough to be saved, go, yes, you're right on that one. That did not come from H-E-L. That's actually true. But 2 Corinthians 5:21, in the breath on the page says, God made him, Jesus, who knew no sin, to become sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Aren't you glad that's what God said? Aren't you glad God didn't say, well, okay, here's the 15 steps to you getting good enough? Aren't you glad he didn't say that? Aren't you glad God didn't say, here are the 9 things you got to do to get good enough to be saved? Aren't you glad God didn't say, I don't know if you're going to get saved. In fact, I don't think you ever are going to be good enough to get saved, so I'm just going to move on from you. You're not going to get saved. Aren't you glad that God said, even though you're not good enough, Jesus is going to be good enough? Even though you're not going to be able to pay the penalty of your own sin, which is death, because you're already dead in it, Jesus is going to be willing and good enough to pay the penalty of your sin. Even though you can't get up out of the grave and up out of the tomb, Jesus is coming up out of the grave and coming out of the tomb for you. Even though you are not good enough to measure up to a perfect, holy God, the perfect, holy God is coming down in the person of Jesus Christ, and he's going to measure up for you. So then we can say, okay, that one, we got one truth and 3 lies. I am not good enough to be saved. And I'm going to go ahead and circle that. But I still have a new story. I'm going to write a line above it. But Jesus was good enough for me. People, that's why we're here tonight. You're like, Lou, we're all at church. We all already know how you get saved. No, no, we don't. Some of you are sitting in this room right now thinking that you have to be good enough to get saved. And you're trying your hardest to get good enough. And you're, good luck getting perfect. And oh, sorry, Jesus, that you had to come down and be perfect and die for me, while I'm over here real busy trying to get perfect. You think, I don't think the enemy isn't in this room right now telling somebody you got to get better to get saved? 100% guarantee you he's in this room right now telling somebody you got to get better to get saved. You got to fix your mess, clean up your problems. You got to straighten all this stuff out somehow if you think you're getting saved. Who do you think you are? And it's a lie. And the way that you break the lie is with the truth. And you say, you're right. I'm not good enough to get saved. That's why it's called grace. And I need grace. So I've been praying today, believing that somebody in this room It's your time in history to get saved right now. You've heard it. You know what the Bible is. You know who Jesus is, generally speaking. You have some kind of framework for the fact that there was a guy that walked on water and died on a cross and did all that stuff. But you've never come to the point of having revelation. That means having your eyes opened and saying, I'll never be good enough to get to God. And that's the best thing I can say. Because when I know that, then I realize that Jesus makes me good enough to become a son or a daughter of God. And how do you get that? You just go to the truth. It is by grace that you're saved through faith. Not of works, so that no one can boast. It is the gift of God. He's holding it right now. And he's saying, you can take the pen in your hand by faith and write, I'm not good enough, but Jesus was good enough for me. And I accept Jesus. I ask him to forgive me for my sin that I can't fix. I ask him to give me brand new life that I can't get on my own. I ask him to save me forever and make me his daughter, make me his son. This is my time in history to get saved right here and right now. This has all been God bringing me to this point of taking the pen and writing a whole new story. Jesus was good enough for me. Therefore, I accept him as my Savior. And I believe it. From this moment into eternity, I am saved. And I wonder, is there anybody that's your story tonight? I want to get saved right now, right here. So you just stand wherever you are. This is my time in history. This is my night. This is my moment. Anybody? Thank you so much. God bless you. Anybody else? Thank you so much. God bless you. Thank you. God bless you. So great. Anybody else? Anybody up here? Anybody in the way back? Anybody in the shadows? This is my time. Thank you so much. God bless you. Anybody else? I know it takes a minute because every time we wait a few seconds, somebody says, this is my night. This is my time. Thank you. God bless each one of you, all three of you. It's so great. So great back here. Yes, sir. Amazing. Yes, young man. So great. Anybody else? God not moving over on this side? God not moving over here? Thank you so much. God bless you. God bless you. Anybody else? I know I'm not good enough, but I start believing right here and right now by faith Jesus was good enough for me. I want to give my life to Jesus and get saved right here tonight. Thank you. God bless you. Anybody else? We're going to pray together. Thank you so much. God bless you. Anybody else? We're done. We're closing. The guys are going to lead. Anybody else? Thank you so much. Anybody? Don't you hate this moment because you're like, I think we're done. And then as soon as you do, somebody stands up. You're like, oh, I'm glad we waited. Thank you so much back there. Anybody else? I want to be saved. So great. Let's pray together. And if you're standing, I want to just lead you in this prayer. It has to be your words because I can't pray it for you. So in your own words, just tell them, dear Jesus, thank you for giving your life for me. I know I could never be good enough to be saved. But Jesus, I thank you that you were good enough for me. I ask you to forgive me for all my sins. I'm asking you to give me a brand new heart and give me a brand new life. I want to be saved. And I want to be one of your children forever. If that's your prayer, just tell him, I believe it and I receive it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.